Dame i gospodo, drago mi vam se pozdraviti večeras. Predstavit ćemo jednu bitnu knjigu, knjigu mađarske autorice koja je napisana na engleskom jezikom. Riječ je o Zofi Loran. Molim vas jedan veliki pljesak za Zofi Loran. Knjigu je s engleskog prevao Srđan Dvornik. Naslov knjige je Feministički izazov socijalističkoj državi u Jugoslaviji. Knjiga koja je, rekao bih, prva povijest feminizma u Jugoslaviji i općenito u istočnoevropskim zemljama. Razgovor ćemo moderirati Danijela Lugarić-Vukas. Molim vas veliki pljesak za Danijelu. Danijela će postavljati pitanja na hrvatskome, Sofija će odgovarati na engleskom jeziku, Sofija inače razumije hrvatski vrlo dobro, radila je veliko istraživanje o ovoj knjizi, ne samo literature, nego i intervjua, tako da je stvarno upućena u tematiku i temu. Sa engleskog će se prevoditi u iz akvarija ovoga Hrva Hefer, molim se veliki pjesak za Hrva Hefer. Ko se ne osjeća sigurnim, može slobodno uzeti ovdje slušalice, dakle hrvatski će biti na kanalu 1, engleski na kanalu 2. Hvala vam lijepa i prepuštam mikrofon Danijelu.
I ko se osjeća sigurnim, također može.
Tako je. Dobro večer svima. Dakle, meni je posebna čast predstaviti našu večerašnju gošću, Zofiju Loran, koja je studirala anglistiku, komparativnu književnost i politologiju, doktorirala je na Srednjoeuropskom sveučilištu u Budimpešti i upravo na temi iz koje je objavljena ova knjiga, dakle, intelektualna povijest feminizma u Jugoslaviji. Ona je objavila mnoštvo tekstova znanstvenih, ali se bavila također i feminističkim aktivizmom. Radila je kao volonterka dugi niz godina na SOS telefonu organizacije NANE za pretučene žene u Mađarskoj i radila je također kao urednica jednog izdavačkog bloka Bora, jel? Koja je objavljivala tekstove naših spisateljica, knjige spisateljice iz bivše Jugoslavije i trenutačno na Cambridgeu se bavi povješću feminističke misli u istočnoj i središnjoj Europi. Dakle, ja moram zahvaliti autorici ne samo zbog toga što je došla ovdje, nego i zbog toga što je meni osobno pričinila veliki užitak dok sam čitala njezinu knjigu, prvo na engleskom jeziku, a potom i u odličnom prijevodu Srđana Dvornika. Znači, to je znanstvena knjiga koja je vrlo živa i vrlo je pitka. Jedan od razloga tomu je to što je autorica uključila i glasove ondašnjih, dakle, feminističkih misliteljica, tako što im je nadjevala čak i naslove nekih poglavlja po riječima koje su izgovarale žene aktivistkinje iz onoga razdoblja. A drugo, zbog toga što je riječ o jednoj od onih knjiga nakon koje imate osjećaj da poznajete osobu koja je tu knjigu napisala, jer je autorica napisala knjigu koliko o jugoslavenskom feminizmu, toliko i o svojoj majci, svojoj baki, svojoj nečakinji, svojoj sestri, pa onda na neki način je svima nama. Tako da, evo, ako niste pročitali, svakako uzmite u ruke tu knjigu. Ona u toj knjizi govori o povijesti razvoja feminističke misli u Jugoslaviji, kako su žene jedne od drugih i od drugih učile ne samo feministički jezik, nego i kako primjećivati stvari oko sebe, pojave oko sebe i tumačiti ih kroz, provlačiti ih kroz okular feminističke kritike. Osim, dakle, što knjiga nudi niz vrijednih historiografskih podataka, ona je i etnografska, kao što sam već spomenula. Dakle, u svojoj knjizi pišeš o sljedećim temama. Rod, interpretacija drugih, svijest, razlika privatno i javno, koja se vrlo često gubi, patrijarhatu, porodici, mjestu žene unutar porodice, o zdravlju žena, o nasilju nad ženama, o odnosu između feminističkog aktivizma i feminizma u akademiji i odnosu žene izvan akademije i feminističkog aktivizma. Kroz te teme prelamaš cijelo jedno dugo razdoblje u bivšoj Jugoslaviji, 70. i 80. godine. Zašto su te teme važne i zašto si odlučila pisati o njima?
Hvala. Možete me čuti?
Ne.
I sad?
Da.
Dobre večer, hvala da ste došli. Meni je velika čast i puno sam sretna da mogu biti ovdje i odgovarat ću na engleskom, malo sam koherentnija na engleskom. Thank you for this very nice introduction, Daniela. So the book is about all of these things and that you just mentioned, and it's because feminism in Yugoslavia in the 70s and 80s was about all of these things. And my work was very much driven by my sources, which was actually for me a big step from working in the field of comparative literature and literary theory, which I felt was always very much, at least the way I studied it, it was very much driven by the theory and not by the actual works. So I extremely enjoyed this transition into a historian and this kind of focus on my sources. So this is the reason why I worked on all of these subjects, but this is also the reason why I enjoyed working on the book. And what you also mentioned briefly, that that I partly wrote this book for the women in my family, but I also wanted to write this book for the women in the region of Eastern Europe or East Central Europe, because I felt that that Yugoslav feminism in the 70s and 80s was not just about Yugoslavia, but about the region and this socialist experience and the ambivalence that came from socialist women's emancipation, which was very, very important in many ways, but also the limitations that came from the fact that socialist societies remained highly patriarchal.
I sad je tu možda zanimljivo pitanje, ono koje se često nekako postavlja u vezi s Jugoslavijom. Jugoslavija se voli egzotizirati, znači ona se često prikazuje kao ono treći put, dakle nije ni prvi ni drugi nego treći, što može biti, što zvuči jako primamljivo i može laskati, ali s druge strane je ono baš ono zanimljiva stupica zbog toga što onemogućava kritički i objektivni pristup određenim temama. Kakav je tvoj stav o tome? Je li Jugoslavija iz perspektive tretmana rodnih tema i feminističke problematike bila doista, je li ju potrebno činiti egzotičnom? Je li ona bila iznimna ili specifična u nečemu, a možda u odnosu na ove druge države u kojima je socijalističke države?
Now that's a very, very interesting question with this Yugoslavia exceptionalism. And I think it's also very complex, because this socialist women's emancipation project is very similar everywhere, also in the Soviet bloc. And you can see that in the sources how all the countries, including Yugoslavia, explicitly until 48, and then not so explicitly, obviously, after the Tito-Stalin split, was taking over the Soviet model of women's emancipation. On the other hand, I find that this partisan tradition and the way women were included into the partisan movement and the extremely important role the affiche played during the Second World War made women's position stronger here than in the other countries in the region. And then what makes Yugoslavia clearly an exception is this feminist, critical feminist circles in the 70s and 80s, because that's something that you don't find, at least not on this level of organization, of publications, of all the art and literature that was coming out from the feminist activities, and that is an exception. In the meantime, I'm not just a historian of Yugoslavia, I'm also a historian of East Central Europe. I also like to add that every single country in this part of the world likes to point out how they are different from the others. And I think that's also very important that there are very interesting stories that make Poland exceptional, that make Czechoslovakia exceptional, that make Albania exceptional in different ways. But when it comes to gender relations and feminism, I think that this story with the partisan women and affiche and then the feminists in the 70s and 80s is super important.
I možda još jedan aspekt o kojem pišeš u svojoj knjizi, a to je taj utjecaj zapadne feminističke misli, znači angloameričke i francuske, koja isto može biti usko povezana s tom pozicijom Jugoslavije u tim 70. i 80. godinama. Naprosto je kolanje informacija bilo lakše i kolanje samo fizičko kretanje ondašnjih feministica je također bilo lakše nego što bi to bilo drugim socijalističkim zemljama. Koliko možemo o tom jugoslavenskom feminizmu, koliki je bio utjecaj zapadne feminističke misli na jugoslavenski socijalizam, koje su feminističke misliteljice najviše utjecale i koliko u jugoslavenskom feminizmu unatoč tim utjecajima možemo govoriti kao nekom ono homegrown feminizmu.
It definitely is a homegrown form of feminism. I think it's very important that feminism is a transnational phenomenon always. And I think it's important to start from there, that feminism is always transnational and there are always influences and there is always dialogue. And another thing that I like to emphasize is that that of course second wave feminism in the West was not the only form of feminism that ever existed, and the term itself second wave is problematic because it suggests that everything that happened before the 60s in the entire 19th century and the rest of the 20th century is just one wave, one homogeneous wave, which of course is not true. But in the meantime, what happens in North America and Western Europe in the 60s and 70s is very important in the sense that it reinvigorates the feminist movement and feminist thinking, which became very much repressed in this post-Second World War phase. And it's very interesting to compare how in the West you have a conservative backlash after the war, whereas in socialist countries you have this amazing social transformation that comes with the Women's Emancipation Project, but how it's declared that okay, this is more or less done and we don't need to talk about it anymore, and it's combined with this very strange form of anti-feminism. So this influence from the West is important here because it gives women a lot of ideas of and some men of how to rethink the existing gender relations. But it's, I think it's very interesting and it's quite different from the 90s, that in the 70s and 80s here, people were thinking of, they were thinking, okay, these Western things are interesting, but let's see what's relevant here. And let's make sense of feminism for Yugoslavia, for this society, for socialism. For example, you don't find, I haven't found almost any translations of Western feminist texts, which didn't come with a Yugoslav commentary immediately. So they always made sure, all the authors, that this is about Yugoslavia, this is relevant for us, and of course we want to know what's happening to women in the world otherwise, but also let's talk about what's important for us. And I think that this is what makes it specifically Yugoslav. And I think that we need to talk a lot about this, because this accusation that feminism is a Western idea is still there. It's very interestingly always here. It was here 100 years ago as well. And it's not just, it's not an East European specificity. When I read about British feminism, there the argument is that this has nothing to do with Britain. It's a French, it's some French perversion. So it's always there in the dynamics. And I just want to mention one more thing, just because we had Slamenka Drakulic here today in the previous panel, that she points out in Smutnik Diesi that Marxism is also not a homegrown theory, but no one ever seemed to be bothered about that.
Da, jo, sad sam mi dala pet tema u kojem, smjerova u kojem možemo ići. Vratit ćemo se na 90-te, jer mi se čine vrlo zanimljive i vrlo važne za cijelu tu genealogiju. I zapravo mi je pitanje koliko su 90-te važne za razvoj feminizma, ali idemo prije sa ovim pitanjem. Kako je Jugoslavija bila država? Znači, naslov knjige Feministički izazov socijalističkoj državi Jugoslaviji. Kako je Jugoslavija bila država iz perspektive tretmana rodnih tema? Znači, u svojoj knjizi nudiš pregršt vrlo zanimljivih primjera. S jedne strane, časopisi su otvoreno se bavili feminističkom tematikom, a s druge strane, postojale su disertacije, spomenula si jednu, Nade Popović-Perišić, koja je bila odbijena u Beogradu, upravo zbog toga što se bavila feminističkom problematikom. Ta disertacija je kasnije objavljena, obranjena u Zagrebu. Časopis Start, za koji znamo da je bio najbolje paralele, ta neka domaća verzija Playboya, sad ja vučem ove neke nespretne paralele sa Zapadom, ali okej, to je valjda da mi je u nekom mentalnom sklopu već usađeno. U svakom slučaju, muški urednici nisu odobravali feministički sadržaj i u knjizi navodiš niz primjera te onoga što bi se moglo označiti kao ograničena liberalnost ili neka ograničena tolerancija. Znači, oni su s jedne strane, urednici časopisa Playboy su pokušavali promijeniti opremu feminističkih časopisa kako bi izmijenili njegovu poruku, pa su primjerice prilog Vesne Kesić o konferenciji Drukca u Beogradu 78. godine, htjeli su staviti naslov Trle babe feminizam. Dakle, na taj način je, to je ta, ono, ta ograničena liberalnost. Znači, sama navodiš u knjizi, dubina i radikalnost kritike države ovisili su o mediju ili javnosti, vremenu kao i temi. Znači, kakva je Jugoslavija bila država iz perspektive tretmana rodnih tema? Vrlo široko pitanje koje možda možeš pokušati, možeš ponuditi barem neki možda onako intrigantni aspekt odgovora.
That's a huge question. But thank you for the examples, because I think that they tell a lot about this complexity that you have an intellectual space, and I think that is also something that we have to acknowledge, that most of the feminist discourse in Yugoslavia in the 70s and 80s was taking place in an intellectual circle. And in the meantime, that's why Start and the popular women's magazines like Bazaar and Start. So these were very important outlets. But you have this complexity that there is space for feminism, but there is also space for anti-feminism, which comes both from the intellectual circles, even from the liberals, so there is some resistance, even in Ljubljana, the punk, especially the women in the punk groups were quite suspicious of the feminist story. And in the meantime, you still have the possibility to publish, because it's sort of part of this idea that that in Yugoslavia there is an open, an intellectual openness for everything, which includes feminism and anti-feminism. And it's there in the journals, like Nada Popović-Perišić is a very good example, but Nadezhda Čačinović told me that it was also very difficult to publish feminist philosophy in philosophical journals. In the meantime, I find it very important that that all of these feminist texts were appearing in all kinds of journals, in like even within academia, because then you reach that audience, the literary scholars, the historians, the philosophers, the sociologists, and to have this open, or to have this broader audience with Start and Bazaar, that was also extremely precious and valuable. And I think it was a very, very brave thing to do. As much as publishing is part of Start, what later criticized by many other feminists, it was a chance to reach this extremely broad audience, which I don't even know whether we have today.
Počinjem na engleskom, ja. Znači, i to je povezano s mojim drugim pitanjem, znači kao što je o državi možemo govoriti kao o nekoj ograničenoj liberalnosti, postavlja se pitanje iz nekih tvojih primjera u knjizi i koliko je feminizam isto tako aktivizam ograničenog dosega. Onda, a sad posebno, jako, samo da prvo se zahvalim na tome što stalno daješ taj imperativ na tome da je, ukazuješ na to da je u Jugoslaviji ono vrijeme postojala i kritička svijest koja je uspjela nekako odmjeriti zapadnjačke misli na ono osobnim primjerima, a i postojao taj vrlo veliki prostor slobode koji je dopuštao različitu ono, polifoniju. E sad, u tom kontekstu to pitanje feminizma kao aktivizma ograničenog dosega, jedan od boljih primjera o kojem govoriš u knjizi je Lepa Mlađenović, njezin uvid da su psihijatrijske bolnice nakon boravka u Italiji totalitarne, i ona je željela zamijeniti taj u Jugoslaviji psihijatrijske bolnice antipsihijatrijom, odnosno tim kompleksnim sustavom jedinice za mentalno zdravlje. I onda njezino uviđanje, citiram sad iz tvoje knjige, da, odnosno njezine riječi iz tvoje knjige, da nismo mogle promijeniti institucije jer nije bilo nikoga iznutra tko ima moć. I to je sad vezano usko iz ovaj tvoj rani odgovor, pitanje časopisa i kako ipak u startu objavljivati radove čak i pod naslovima s kojima se nismo slagali. Zašto se to činilo i kako se to polje feminističkog utjecaja ipak moglo širiti unatoč granicama koje su postojale?
I think that this is it's a huge difference between like the healthcare system, including psychiatry, which is even today is super closed, super hierarchical, and it was a very important realization on behalf of Lepa Mlađenović that this would be a lost battle, and that's a big difference between that phenomenon or the Start case, because I think that what Vesna Kesić and Slavenka Drakulić found was that yes, it's difficult, yes, there's a lot of machismo going on, but you still can achieve certain things. And there is still these limitations for feminist activism, which partly comes from the socialist system itself, because however it was open, it was still not a democracy, which had some limitations. Like you couldn't organize women in the factories, for example, because that would have stepped outside the control. Then feminism steps outside of the control of the state. In the meantime, there were, I think, these aspects which no one predicted how important could be, or activities like the SOS helplines. I'm not sure that the people who allowed these SOS helplines to be set up were aware what kind of an outreach they meant. And you can see from all the publications after the SOS helplines get set up, that all of a sudden women from all over the country, from all kinds of social backgrounds, have this kind of access to feminism, and that I think that could have been a very good basis for more grassroots organizing. But then you have 1991 and the country falls apart, and we don't know. We will never find out what would have happened.
To je sljedeće pitanje o kojem smo i danas razgovarali, pitanje rata. I kad se govori o ratu na ovim prostorima, onda se govori o žrtvama i o krvnicima i nekako se ta nijansirana priča gubi. Stječe se dojam iz tvoje knjige, nijansirana priča u tom pojednostavljenom narativu, iz tvoje knjige se stječe dojam da je taj jugoslavenski feminizam bio jedan od tih tihih gubitnika rata, jer se izgubila, dakle, osim što se učio feministički jezik, učilo se prepoznavati pojave i tumačiti ih kroz, provlačiti ih kroz feminističku kritiku, također su se izgubile forme organizacije koje su postojale u Zagrebu, Beogradu, Ljubljani, to su neki centri u kojima ti najviše pišeš, i izgubili su se časopisi u kojima su se mogli publicirati radovi. Pa kako je tvoje mišljenje o tome kako je rat utjecao na jugoslavenski feminizam?
It's one of the reasons why I stopped writing the book in 91 was because I felt that this is such a sad story, and I wanted to have the good story, the positive one, in one book. Because, yes, like the networks were lost, like the connections and this constant exchange, and much of the forums, it's also very important, I think, to acknowledge how important feminism still was in the 90s, and how this anti-war feminist activism was building itself from the experience in the 70s and 80s. But it's a completely new page, and what's probably most interesting is that that all of this, I think the activist knowledge could be transferred much better to the 90s, but the academic knowledge and all the theory that was sort of forgotten, which is on the one hand because of the war and that the country falls apart, but I think also because we tended to think in the 90s that whatever was produced during socialism was just not good enough. And it's also very much of a post-socialist story, the way all this academic expertise is not acknowledged.
Danas se o Jugoslaviji često, danas je Jugoslavija često tabuizirana tema. U tom smislu govoriti o jugoslavenskom feminizmu je neka dvostruka tabuizacija. Jesi li se, i s kakvim reakcijama si se susrela pišući ovu knjigu i skupljujući materijale za nju?
I was more or less working in a bubble, I have to admit, because I was in touch mostly with the feminist women from the 70s and 80s, but also feminist scholars from nowadays. So it was not, that part was not difficult, because the people I was talking to here and in the former Yugoslav space knew what I was doing. In the meantime, it was shocking how in other countries no one knew about this. In Hungary, people were laughing at me for doing this because they thought it was something irrelevant and completely obscure. And I'm still, you know, I'm telling them. And now there is quite, I find it very important to talk about this topic there. And now there is at least a certain audience who knows and appreciates this history. So I think that part for me was more difficult. The other thing that I find as an outsider important and also quite difficult is to be respectful of everybody's sensitivities and how everyone has different memories, different and a different kind of relationship to the Yugoslav past, and I really don't. I don't want in any way to question the way people remember And actually just to add, this is why I decided that I will not analyze the interviews, because I felt that it's really not my place in this story to start cross-reading interviews with the sources, because it's important how people remember, and of course that memory changes. We all rewrite our past in our heads, and it was more important to me to somehow bring back the voices and to bring back these memories as memories in the book. I try to stay out of the personal narratives, and as a scholar, out of respect for the people who gave me the interviews.
Pretpostavljam da kad si prijavljivala i temu doktorskog rada i kad si razmišljala o toj temi, da si imala neka očekivanja, i onda što se dogodilo kad si počela skupljati intervjue? Jesu li postale neke stvari koje su te posebno iznenadile ili koje su posve promijenile tvoj način razmišljanja o toj temi koju si imala inicijalno?
Of course, yes. That's why I started with the written sources. So the research started with a lot of library research, because I wanted to make sure that I had an idea of what was going on. And I only started the interviews after I did my homework in the library. What surprised me, a lot of things, I think a lot of things surprised me, but what maybe the best thing was that all of the interviewees were super open with me, and that was I think that was quite exceptional, and I think that's a very feminist way of doing interviews, that you are willing to share these personal things with the other person. After you establish a certain feminist understanding with each other, and it happened many times that someone told me something and later they said, listen, like, I really don't want this to get out. And I think it was clear that I will never give out anything that people ask me not to. It turned out to be a very important way of collecting more sources, because that's another problem, that our feminist past is not archived properly. And finally, at least amongst historians, we started to talk about this problem of archiving feminist activism, because, again, because of this whole public and private division, and what in the previous panel people were also discussing, that the everyday and the domestic it's still not considered important enough, so it doesn't end up in the archives. But doing the interviews meant that I could look at people's personal collections and use them for the book.
U svojoj knjizi o jugoslavenskom feminizmu govoriš kao o neofeminizmu, i možeš li nam pojasniti taj pojam, zašto neofeminizam? I u vezi s time, možeš li nam pojasniti zašto si odabrala o feminizmu govoriti kao o pokretu kojemu je u temelju neslaganje? Što to znači?
I talk about neo-feminism, or in the English book I call it New Yugoslav Feminism, because this is how the authors were referring to themselves in the 70s and 80s. And actually, It's not just in Yugoslavia. It's very much part of the second wave discourse that feminists talk about this kind of new feminism as new feminism to differentiate it from the previous waves. So that's why I chose it. But I also in several places in the book I point out that not everybody used it for themselves, so I wouldn't call the entire phenomenon neo-feminism. In the meantime, I try to preserve this term because it was used by the authors in the sources. And I was very much struggling with what to call this, so we translated dissidents as dissidence, and neslaganje is dissent in English. And I was trying to find a term that describes feminism in Yugoslavia at this time the best. And it's very much connected to my to one of my bigger questions in the bigger context, which is this whole phenomenon of dissidence and dissent in East Central Europe, where you don't have feminism, you actually almost don't have any women at all. And what grows out of especially the liberal Central European dissidence is a completely gender blind and very often misogynistic kind of politics, which then completely defines what becomes of these new democracies after 1989. That it's these macho men who have their universalistic human rights agenda and don't think that that women are worthy of any kind of special attention. So I wanted somehow to show how a feminist kind of criticism of socialism is possible, and that it very much has its place in this broader context of the broader context of the research on dissent and dissidence. At the same time, obviously there is a difference between dissidents who ended up in prison, in forced labor camps, regularly were beaten up by the police, didn't have anywhere to publish, so they were publishing in Samizdat and Tamizdat publications, and that's a huge difference between, there's a huge difference between this kind of dissidents and feminists in Yugoslavia who published, okay, it was not easy, okay, you had to fight with the editors, but you still could publish in many, many, many places. And you could use the student cultural centers and the universities for events. So that's why I decided that, okay, this should not be called dissidence, but dissent, because in the meantime, there is this very important element of disagreement with neslaganje in it.
I sad malo si nas, stavila si nas ovo, nakon 89. godine, možemo jedno pitanje vezano uz odnos kapitalizma i feminizma. Postoji brojne istraživanja suvremena koja govore o tome da je kapitalizam zapravo se oslanja na repatriarhalizaciju i da je uvođenje kapitalističkih društvenih odnosa različito utjecalo na žene i na muškarce, jer je kapital u suštini ovisan o institucionaliziranom patrijarhatu. Koji je tvoj stav o tom pitanju?
It definitely has been happening since 89 with the introduction of capitalism, that it's again a new kind of patriarchy, and there is a strong retraditionalization of gender relations. I agree. In the meantime, it is also present in socialist countries, this this patriarchal approach, and what many scholars write about, and we often talk about, with this double burden on women. The unpaid labor of women is also a strong part of the socialist economy, which was not the intention from the beginning. But there is a retraditionalization starting in the 60s, more or less, which makes it, which maintains the patriarchal relations. But what happens after 89 is a much, much stronger and a much more open attack on gender equality. And I think also in the previous panel, this came up a little bit, that some of the rights that we thought were given are being taken away from us women, both in terms of reproductive rights and child care.
Ja bih možda samo podsjetila da je Stalin krajem 20. i početkom 30. rekao žensko je pitanje kod nas riješeno, i to mu je bio glavni argument za ukidanje sovjetskog ženog dijela, dakle, organizacije žena. Kada, bilo je pitanje na prethodnom panelu, koliko nam je feminizam danas potreban i za što? I kada ćemo moći reći da je da su te bitke gotove, da je žensko pitanje rješeno?
Not in the near future, I would say. And we need feminism for everything, for our survival, for our sanity. I think that radical feminism is a good term in the sense that what it points out is that inequalities are deeply rooted in society, and it grows out from deep in the ground, and then it penetrates everything in our lives, every single aspect. And we need feminism to have this systemic criticism of patriarchy, to work on the elimination of the oppression of women that is still very much present.
Redu, ti u jednom trenutku definiraš, imajući na umu da se shvaćanje feminizma razlikuje od osobe do osobe, od konteksta do konteksta, definiraš feminizam na sljedeći način. Feminizam je jedan oblik humanizma, određen poštovanjem i odgovornošću, odgovornošću feminiskinje, feminizam spram svoje zajednice, tako i kao utvrđivanje kome i čemu pripada odgovornost za status quo. Nazivati sebe feminiskinjom također je performativan čin kojim se žena ili muškarac želi povezati s feminizmom. Što znači, što si mislila pod time da je feminizam performativan čin?
That you not only describe yourself as a feminist, it's coming from speech act theory, which you know. that it's not only a description, but you make a political statement by saying that you're a feminist and that you identify with this political position, and you take you take on solidarity with other women, and you are willing to engage in this political struggle against the oppression of women. I also, for the book, I found it analytically important to use this term in order to differentiate feminism from socialist women's emancipation politics, which I don't think is not important. I think it's extremely important, but there is a difference between a focus on these complex layers of oppression of women and a set of policies or even subsuming the question of gender equality to class equality.
I mislim da ne moramo posebno utvrđivati da je feminizam i danas važan, no možemo pričati o tome gdje, kako razvijati svijest o važnosti feminizma i gdje učiti, gdje crpiti znanje. Ti spominješ u svojoj knjizi da su jugoslavenske feministice osim Zapada također se nadovezivala na neke pokrete koji su postojali u Kraljevini SHS. Pa evo pitanje za danas, kako čime se sada baviš, zašto te zanima ta tema šira intelektualna povijest feminizma u istočnoj i srednjoj Europi i gdje ti se čine da su te niše gdje se krije znanje? Do you want me to ask a question in English?
So it's both about my new work and what is what I find in the history of feminism important.
No, it's just a question of where we can where we can. Pitanje bilo gdje se dalje feminizam, kako danas, odakle danas crpiti znanja o nova znanja za nove feminističke ideje. Nešto se na Zapadu dogodilo s feminizmom, gdje postoje svježi glasovi?
Okay. That's a great question. It's, and I think it's in our history it's in our feminist history, the fresh voices and the new knowledge. It's not, we shouldn't be looking for something that doesn't exist. It's much more important to go back and look at the past, because that's one of the, I think that's one of the big, that's one of the ways we lose a lot as feminists, that we always forget our past and we don't learn enough from the past. And it's there in every generation, it's not just our generation. It's very much there in the second wave, and it's there before. I think it's extremely interesting to read feminist texts from the turn of the 19th and 20th century, and to find that women were talking about the same problems as we are talking today, and to learn from them and see what worked and what didn't work, and part of the reason why I also wrote this book was to show how complex a feminist critique of a regime can be, and to learn from the different strategies and the failures.